application for investigation or an application for review. The application for investigation is pretty straightforward, as much as you would anticipate just by the front of its name. If you have, you have to file like two citizens, two residents of Ontario, each one. But if you have evidence that some kind of piece of legislative environmental legislation is being violated, and for some reason the ministry responsible is not doing their job, or has done a bad job, or whatever, if they're not doing it, it's not happening, then you can file through my office a request for investigation, provide the evidence you have to support that. Mm-hmm. And that goes through me, goes to the ministries involved. And they have to become accountable. They have 60 days to consider this, and they can come back and have to say, okay, we're going to do the investigation, or we're not. If we're going to do it, we'll let you know when we finish. But if we're not going to do the investigation, they have to give reasons why they're not. And that brings out the public forum, and I oversee and review them. So if they're going to refuse to, at least we know why, and at least they're on the public record, and then this is subject to my review and criticism in that regard. We don't have a lot of investigation, we do have some. I'll talk about a couple of examples. Where's my book? But more importantly, the more important one is the request for review. Any two citizens of Ontario can request that the review of any act, regulation, policy, or such as license and permits that relate to the environment, if you feel that they are not adequately protecting the environment, you have good reason to believe they're not. Or you can ask for a review of the need for something that doesn't exist by way of an act, regulation, policy, or license or permit. And this is a very powerful tool, and a lot of NGOs use this to get the government to respond to something that has to be changed or to create something new. The process is just the same as investigation. You file this up, two people have to file it. You file this application, comes through my office, it goes to the ministry or several ministries sometimes that may be involved in this, and they have 60 days to respond. And they can either do it, and that's fine, and take some time to do it and get the report back, or they can choose not to do it, but they have to give reasons. And they give reasons, and those reasons are subject to my review. Now, the biggest open secret that hasn't, that nobody's ever figured out is that the ministries generally turn them down because they're right, they're trying to avoid doing anything. They don't want to do the review, or they certainly don't want to, get a new law or something. So what they haven't figured out, that's probably the worst thing they can do, because then it gives me a clean slate to say what I think, right? If they actually agree to do it, I have to say, okay, well, let's see what you produce. And when they produce something, I can maybe comment on that, but, if they go ahead and do the review, one can't complain. But if they won't do the review, and they give reasons, or better be darn good reasons, because I'll be honest about that, or if they're not, good reasons, then if there's a real need to review that, so then I look into it. And I say, well, I may have the full depth and resources to go into full depth. So I'm looking at this, this looks pretty reasonable, that looks pretty reasonable, what's going on here, and I can make recommendations to government, etc. So I can bring the issue up. But this, if you're an NGO, understand this is a way that you can actually get the government to respond to your issues. Because that's the biggest thing governments do, of course, is just ignore you, right? And if they don't talk about it, there's no problem. And you can't be held to account for something you're not talking about. But this request for review mechanism is how NGOs get their issues talked about. And they might get turned down, likely to get turned down. But that doesn't matter, because then it's in my report, it's talked about, it's reviewed, and you can get some attention on it. And of course, the media sees it all, and the media starts asking questions, well, why not? This is reasonable, etc. Right? So it's a powerful tool, these applications. And I thought I'd talk about just quickly about five of them that are in my report. The first one is we looked at an application to review Regulation 116/01. Regulation 116/01 is a regulation on the Environmental Assessment Act relating to the requirements for approving electricity projects. Now, you would know this better as the York Energy Center down at the Holland Marsh, right? And I'm sure you guys have heard the controversy associated with that. Well, this is the regulation, and of course it comes up as controversy to the York Energy Center in Holland Marsh down in, I'm sure you might have heard of Oakville, the big plant down in Oakville that just got canceled by the premier. What's that about? And it was in my report. is the process that was flawed. That the regulation 116.01, what it said was, we're going to get streamlined for point driven regulation for small electrical generation. So for little hydro, for little solar, for gas plants producing electricity greater than 5 megawatts. Well, implied by that, you see, they say less than 4 megawatts is so small, that's just like a building size, kind of thing for big commercial buildings, that's exempt. But, and when you say, well, greater than 5, the implication in people's mind was, oh, those are fairly small ones. They didn't realize that the greater than 5 went all the way to 900 megawatts, which is the one in Oakville was 900 megawatts, which is way bigger than nuclear power plant. So there was no upside on that, and you had a streamlined short course, which was proponent driven, and basically said, you know, you go through a screening process, do I do this, yes, I did this, yes, I did this. It's like a kid writing his own report card, you know. I did great, here. It was intended in most people's mind for small things, but it was being applied for big things, and it didn't have any. It allowed the OPA, the Ontario Power Authority, when they put out the contracts, to not have any site selection criteria. There really were no site selection. The companies bid, and it's not the company's fault. They're not slamming the companies, please. The companies just followed the rules. But the way the bidding was set up was that, you know, you have a piece of land you want to put a power plant on, you have a piece of land to put a power plant, well, give me a bid on the price for your power plant. We don't care where the land is. And so whoever won on the business deal, well, your land became the spot. Well, that's no way to site a 900 megawatt power plant. And we found that out, didn't we? The premier had to go and cancel the deal because it wasn't a good spot. And, you know, there's certainly been a lot of controversy with the one down in York as well. So, but it goes back to the mistake that was made was this darn regulation. It was wrong. It should have had a cap on it. It should have said, I don't know what number, you know, make a number, maybe 50 megawatts or something like that. Small gas plants. Yeah, you can have a small gas plant. In a lot of locations, not too much of the surface. But 900 megawatts or the one down in York is about just less than 500 megawatts is different. So that those are, and that also, by the way, written up loud because citizen group filed an application. They turned it down. I was able to write it up. And I'm still dealing with the company's lawyers who are after my lawyers, so let them sort that out. But at least we got to bring it, put it up on the table. Another example of something, the kind of thing applications allow to happen, is one that there's one article called "When Is a Pit Not a Pit?" A strange thing, Eastern Ontario, some 12 years ago or so, somebody has this piece of land out there and starts extracting sand from selling, and the Ministry of Natural Resources normally approve any kind of pit under the Agri Resources Act, which is a licensing procedure. It has operating conditions and rehabilitation requirements and such things, right? Well, they argued with it, and somehow the MNR, because things go wrong in all these ministries, they successfully argued and said, well, this sand was being removed to improve the lands for agriculture. So it was just a matter of sort of recontouring. And so they didn't need an agri resources, and MNR went along with it and said, oh, okay, you don't need an agri resources license, you can operate this because you're just improving the land, right? Mm-hmm. 12 years later, they had taken out 163,000 tons. That's a lot of land improvement, you know. You know how many trucks that is? 163,000 tons. And they've never had a permit under the Agri Resources Act, and all the neighbors had to put up with it. There was no license, there was no rules, no whole thing. And that was brought to our attention. I slammed them. They haven't changed anything yet, but at least they have to flinch when we bring that kind of thing to light. It may not help, you know, end the thing down there in this particular one. We've probably summoned them enough, they won't try that again somewhere else. Another one, story called Too Much Time Wasted with respect to a groundwater investigation. This one's down in Cambridge, and what was happening here, and it turns out, I can't say who the applicant was, I don't think it's public, but we had an applicant, a corporate applicant in that case. This is a big development corporation, and they had a mall, have a mall down in Cambridge, and they were, I think it was, there's they're, I think it was Tim Hortons or something, they had a new tenant that were building up, you know, they're going to build some kind of new tenant in the sort of parking area, you know, and they were excavating the hole and such things, and they ran into trichloroethylene, which is organic solvent, not nice, nasty stuff, and what the hell's it doing in our parking lot, right? It was a little of the grade, there was sort of down grade, and then they start a little, then they find out, well, Ministry of Environment's known about this for a while, and it's in that property, it's in the property above, it's in the property above, it's the property, oh, well, it goes up the hill, and it's in all the dust, you know, it's industrial companies, and what's going on? So the whole thing starts, and what happened was, it went on for years, in that the Ministry of Environment just couldn't seem to get their act together. They were going in and see some of these companies saying, well, we want a sample on your property, and they come to say, no, well, screw you, we don't want to see anything on our property, because we have to find stuff that's toxic, we have to clean it up, you know. Anyway, of course, the Ministry of Environment has the legal authority to issue orders, but they were not doing so. And the whole thing was stalled. Meanwhile, the applicants down below, I mean, they're a big commercial corporation, but they have the legal rights too. They're the ones, they're having problems. They were talking about, you know, they're selling that mall, so now they can't sell it because there's a cloud over it, and you know, they cleaned up as much as they could. They put in a big groundwater barrier and stuff to try to stop more stuff coming down. It's like a tremendous expense to the corporation, but Mr. Garment wasn't getting the problem solved, wasn't getting the problem solved. So they filed a request for investigation and said, and we went after the Ministry of Environment. And all of a sudden, a strange thing happened. No sooner did they file a request for investigation and my office got involved, and all of a sudden, the Ministry of Environment, before anything happened, the Ministry of Environment said, oh no, we're already on it, like we're doing it. And all things seemed to pick up very, coincidentally, just picked up very quickly. There's still some problems, some issues there, but the things have come a long way, just by the fact that they filed the, well, coincident with the fact that they filed the permit. And they built trails and portages, mostly trails. Yeah, up and government, of course, everybody says they want to increase tourism, it's one reason to press the economic area, beautiful wilderness, you know, features and things, and they got all the permits and everything to build, in one case, over 100 kilometer trail down Lake Temiscaming in that general area, quite remarkable. And these guys just, you know, real serious people go up and push and cut trails for fun. If you've ever done anything like that, that's hard work, believe me, and stuff, but they built these trails. And everything was very urgent. And the forest management plan comes up for review, and of course they join in the forest management plan process. And these trails, and it's fine. Go through all the various reviews and processes, etc. At the end of the day, the forest management comes up and says, "Oh yeah, but we're going to clear cut within 30 meters of your trails." Well, if you just built a 100 kilometer trail. And, you know, looking for the best vistas out of the beautiful Lake Nipissing, and then they're going to come to forestry operations in 30 meters, that's like the width of this room. Somehow that didn't seem to support the tourism and wilderness values, right? And they became very frustrated that they had gone and done everything right. So what we had, what I was able to do, we'll see if it has any traction in the long runs or long-term battles. And in fact, in the end, of course, they lost that because the forest management plan did come out with these small separation distances. But then they filed a request for review. They said, look at the process must be flawed because, you know, these are what we call non-timber forest values, these recreational tourism values. They do have value. We're supposed to manage the forest to protect those values. And clearly it didn't happen. We did everything right. We participated every step of the way and got not one concession or not one recognition of our needs. So it's not working. So they pursued the request for review, which the minister turned down, but turned me loose on them, and I was able to say, as a landlord's problem, say, look, they've got a point. They clearly had values. We recognize those values generally. They weren't protected in the plan by any kind of reasonable standard. And so maybe we should redo these forest management plan process and have maybe the Ministry of Tourism involved or other tourist interests, something, because in the long-term value, you can cut the trees once every 80 years, but every year you can get tourists come back if you've got recreational features. It's much better for the forest, it's much better for the economy, to protect some of these what we call non-timber forest values. So see how there's a range of different kinds of issues all driven by applications. for review and investigation in the case. And this gives you a sense, and it also gives you a sense of the range of things my office works on across the province.